Hey everybody, I want to share something with you regarding a urgent series that we're gonna give to you right now. Some may say that they've heard this before. Some may say this is recent. Some may say I need to hear it again. Some may say I've never heard this before. And what we're talking about is the series that we're in called Futures. The reason why, in fact, listen, I'm gonna exaggerate this for you. See this? Literally, as a pastor, this is what my heart feels like regarding the future series. I am rolling up my sleeves because this is the reality of what has happened at the church that I pastor and over the radio ministry and television ministry that we are involved in. And here it is. I rolled up my sleeves to dive back into it because there is a whole new generation of believers. Thank God. Many of them are Gen Z, millennials, young people, they know nothing about Bible prophecy. In fact, they've never heard of it. There's another generation that says, I've heard the word and I don't want to know anything about it. Listen, the world is being shaken. And so what I've done is I've rolled up my sleeves and deliberately delivered a series called Futures. And what we want to introduce to you, first of all, is what we're calling Foundations. Because how do you know the Bible's true? How can you prove, why should I ever read the New Testament? No, I'm serious, listen. Why would I read the New Testament ever if I haven't read the Old? Because the New Testament tells me that this is what the prophet said that was to be fulfilled. That's the New Testament. How do you know it's true? Unless the Old Testament prophecies told you that this is gonna happen. And that's why Futures and our opening to the series Foundations, it's needed. It's needed in your life because how do you know that what you believe is true? Can you trust the Bible? Why do I need to know about the Bible future events? Who cares? Jesus cared. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob cared. The God of the prophets cared. And listen, we're heading toward, not away from, we're heading toward the book of Revelation. You should care. And so I am deliberately, without any apology, diving headfirst into a series that I pray will rock your world to bring you to a firm foundation of why you should have absolute hope in these seemingly hopeless days. I'm dead serious. I hope this transforms your life. It already is. I'm hearing from people that it's transforming their lives, and that can happen to you too. So grab your Bibles, get ready, gather a friend, by the way. Go to jackhibbs.com, tell them, jackhibbs.com, join us, and we'll do this together online here in this viewing platform, wherever you're visiting with us. So let's get into the Word of God together. Friend, everything that you're going to be hearing in this series, you must remember this first. The foundation is God loves me. He has hope for me, and God expects my faith to grow. Faith, hope, and love. That should be at the top of your notepad as we go through this study. Everything there will be our building point. The first thing that we see this morning, jot it down if you would, regarding our Foundations and the Futures series is this, the future of faith. Mark that down. Number one, the future of faith. You say, what on earth does that mean? The future of faith. I want you to understand that what I'm about to say, here's a disclaimer up front, is not bombastic. I am not exaggerating. This is not what pastors are supposed to say on a Sunday morning. It's 100% true. And it's this, your faith is the greatest possession you have. You need to know that. Now, listen, if your life has been cruise, easy, smooth, no bumps up until now, then that doesn't make much of an impact to you. But if your life has been normal like the rest of ours, and you've been smacked in the face a few times, spiritually speaking or maybe physically speaking, God's promises to you mean everything, and that means that you exercise faith to cling on to God's promises. Listen, faith is an absolute necessity, listen, in our lives, but it's very critical as to where it is applied because every human being
exercises faith. Every single one of us. But for me to say to you, your faith is the greatest possession that you have, don't take that lightly. You lose that and you lose life. You give up on that and you lose your hope. You give up on that and you lose your future. Very, very critical. Very important that we begin to build this series upon the statement regarding the future of faith for us as individuals. The Bible says in Hebrews 11, verse 1, now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Look at it on the screen. Mark the verse down, Hebrews 11, 1. This is a very, very cute, seemingly benign verse. It appears on your little memorization scripture cards. You'll see it posted on someone's Instagram, and it's such a sweet sentiment. Oh, no, it's not. It is an absolute bold declaration of a reality that some people look at it and say, I don't get it. And some people look at it and will say, I can't live without it. Amen. This is absolutely spectacular. Faith by definition, listen, everybody, faith by definition assumes a future. You all know that, right? Write that down. Faith by nature assumes a future. Every one of us have faith in something. In someone, I hope it's Christ. I trust it's Christ. But to even speak about faith, it assumes that there's a future. In other words, faith is something that is used, yes, regarding the past, as we shall see, yes, in the current, but also for the future. That's an assumption. Listen, it's a logical assumption. It's reasonable. You can defend that. And so the goal of this series is to establish that very thing, that all that you hear is to build your faith, not scare you. I'm gonna quote my good friend, Dr. Ed Heinzen. Wonderful statement Dr. Ed made. God did not give us Bible prophecy to scare us. He gave us Bible prophecy to prepare us. And that's a great word. So number one under this point is this: past foundations build faith. Mark that down. This is a very, very important part of your life, believe it or not. Past foundations, I'll explain that, build faith. Again, the book of Hebrews, chapter 10, verse 9. By faith, he, Abraham, dwelt in the land of promise as a foreign country, dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. That's faith. Wow. For he waited for the city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. The life of Abraham. What do we know? We look back at Abraham's life. Watch this. It's pretty cool. Abraham was given a promise by God about the future. And everything about Abraham's life, though you and I now are viewing it in real time in the past, builds our faith. This is why it's so important that you and I study the life and do what's called biographical studies of great men and women of God before us. You should be doing that in your time. By the way, I can't believe I'm about to say this, but Amazon Prime, if you have Amazon Prime and you go to the Christian section, they have remarkable documentaries about Martin Luther, John Huss, John Knox, William Tyndale. They've got Richard Wurmbrand most recently, Dietrich Bonhoeffer. And I've seen them all. Very accurate, very well done. I'm impressed. Why do we even look at such things? Because those who have gone on before us, those who are to us in the past, are great people to learn from. And we start with Abraham. When I study and read and learn from the life of Abraham or any Old Testament example, what does it do? It builds my faith. Why? Because everything about them, this is why we love them, but we don't have to see it. Everything about their life is based upon the promise God gave them. Ladies and gentlemen, are you sitting down? That's called prophecy. See, you think prophecy is the dragon with 10 horns. And this beast rises out of the sea, and you run out of church. We'll get to those parts. They're pretty cool, but I'm going to really get you ready for it. But when the Bible says in Genesis 3:15, for example, when God says that from the woman the Messiah is going to come, from Eve, that is the first prophetic eschatological statement in the Bible. Salvation. It's not the statue's 10 toes or the dragon. God's first prophetic message is salvation after this Adam and Eve fumble. Salvation will come to you. And that's the entire Bible announcing to you. It's all prophetic if you think about it. It's beautiful. Past foundations build faith. By the way, please mark this in your mind. If your faith today in your mind is something like a fallback, or it's something I go to when things get tough, it's my spare tire, it's my, what's the word? Break glass in case of fire. You know, this faith, you know, I'm good. Let me ask you something. Do you need more faith? I do.
Are the struggles of life causing you to doubt who you are, where your journey in life is headed? The one who doubts is like waves of the sea, blown and tossed by the wind. Jesus Christ provides comfort and peace in the midst of your doubt. You only need to believe. It's our desire that through Jesus Christ you will know real life.
Has your faith been strengthened? Are you growing? Have the things of God and the promises of God become more real to you? I'm going to assume that's true because you're here. Think about it. And you come at a cost. And I'm not talking about getting sick. It's flu season. Man, can I say this? It's flu season. We're probably going to get the flu this season. It's called flu season. So what? Every year, there's been a flu season every year for like the last 10,000 years. But listen, with all of this and all that's coming, think about it, in the world around us, you're going to need a greater faith. So how do I get a greater faith? This is the right spot. Because you're going to have such an appreciation for the Bible, you're going to have such a dependence upon the Bible, and you're going to say, you know what? Wow. God loves me so much, He told me these things in advance. He didn't want me to be scared, He wanted me to be prepared. Past foundations build faith. Secondly, current foundations build faith. You see, what is that? That is putting into practice what we know, what we believe. Current foundations build faith. And what I mean by that is that you today have God and His Bible as your go-to foundation. Where do you go to when your world is rocked? Where do you go to when you see something happening on the news or in your family or in your life? Where do you go? Do you go to the Bible? Because listen, we can do that now in our current foundation situation, building faith, because we learn from the past that God keeps His word to His patriarchs. He kept His word to all of those biblical personalities that you read about. And you love reading the book of Psalms because David and others are lamenting and revealing their hearts, and God comes in, and you love all that because, listen, the past builds faith, and it carries you right now to the present in this situation. Right now, what are you don't say anything, but what are you going through right now? A, will freak you out and cause you to panic, or B, you're going to realize, wow, God's in control. I don't understand what's going on. His word's true. You can trust Him. Abraham did. Joshua did. And I'm going to do it. Amen. I'm going to do it. You ever see somebody when they make up their mind? I'm going to do it. You ever see people jump off of like cliffs? I love heights. I can go right to the edge of the Empire State Building. I love that feeling. It's like, yes! Woo! I love that. I don't fear heights. I just, I just don't. It's probably not good. It's kind of overdeveloped, maybe. But I cannot jump off a cliff, I don't know why, into water. There's something about that. It's like, I don't know. Because in my mind, my luck, the biggest fish in the whole lake would be swimming just below the surface the moment I left the edge. Or there'd be I'd notice that there's a sandbar right there. Something would happen. Freaks me out. But there's some people, you know that moment where they say, I'm doing it. Let's go. Like, some of these rides that there used to be a place called Disneyland. It was once in a galaxy far, far away. But I don't do rides. I love airplanes, and you can put me upside down and inside out, and I don't care how fast or slow. Let's do it. Airplanes. God made airplanes. Makes perfect sense to me. Airplanes were built. I don't get roller coaster rides. Ain't gonna happen. You know why? I'm standing in line, and all I'm thinking about is, who built this? Who were they? Were they on drugs the day they built this? Who designed this? I need to talk to somebody. I don't like it. And so what happens? We get right up there, and I step out, and my granddaughter goes by herself. That's what happens. Papa, you're a chicken. That's right, chicken, right here. Not gonna go. I don't have faith in that stuff. But the moment somebody says, I got it, let's do it. Shouldn't we not be like that with faith? Yes. God has never let you down. You may have misunderstood what God has done. That's most often our situation. But he's never let you down. Never. And you can build a foundation of faith on what's going on in the current world around us. The world in the next couple of months, the world will be discussing in Davos the global economic world problem. The world is in an unprecedented problem right now. The world. And they're going to be discussing the global economic community. If you know Bible prophecy, you're saying, oh, wow, I'm going to be watching this. Why? Because we're going to watch everything through the lens of what we know from the Bible. Does any of this stuff in the news apply to my current situation? And of course, you can begin to see that religious freedoms and liberties and the direction of our nation and world. All of these things, Jesus said, when you see these things beginning to come to pass, when you just see the little bit of the sun peeking up on the eastern sky, you know that my coming is at the door. How awesome is that? And you should be excited about that. That ministers to us. I look for every opportunity to insert this quote because it's so sweet to my soul. It's blessed me many times. But when we talk about the current foundation and situation and how we need to have faith, the Bible tells us, I'm going to give you this Bible verse and then this quote. The Bible tells us in 1 Chronicles 12:32, it's an amazing statement. And this is what I pray for this church. And from the tribe of Issachar, there were 200 leaders of the tribe with their families. All these men understood the signs of the times and knew the best course for Israel to take. That should be a testimony of your faith and your family and your walk with God and this church. We discern the times and the seasons in which we live according to the Bible, and that information causes you and I to know what we ought to do next as believers. And that's going to bring you hope. Amen. It's going to bring you strength. It's going to bring to you faith. And the love of God will settle your heart. It's awesome. That quote is from one of my favorite people in all the world. Can't wait to meet him. Samuel Adams, patriot, founding father, governor of Massachusetts, signer of the Declaration of Independence, rebel. He was. Creator of the Boston Tea Party, right? I mean, he did a lot of fun stuff, this guy. We have appealed to heaven for the justice of our cause, and in heaven we have placed our trust. Numerous have been the manifestations of God's omnipotence in sustaining us. We have been reduced to distress, and the arm of omnipotence has raised us up. Let us still rely in humble confidence on Him who is mighty to save. Good tidings will soon arrive. We shall never be abandoned by heaven while we act worthy of its aid and protection. Isn't that a great statement? And I love that because all that is biblical truth. Let's live our lives. We are not going to close the curtains and hide at a time like this. We're the ones running around the ship throwing out life rafts to people while people are hiding in their cabins scared.
It's our desire that through Jesus Christ you will know real life.
I had a lady come out. I was doing a wedding last night in Palm Desert, and there was some woman going through the foyer of the hotel. And I was talking to the father of the bride, and we're hugging. We've known each other forever. We're hugging and talking and carrying on. And this woman comes up, and she goes, "Where's your mask, the two of you? Where's your mask?" And he jumps right out of the gate, and he said, "I'm good, lady. I already had it. I can't get it, and I can't give it away. I've had it." And she starts arguing with him. "You don't know that, and what about you?" And I looked at her, and she was older than me. And I said, "She said, where's your mask? You want a mask?" And I said, "No, I don't want a mask. I'm good." And her husband walks up and he says, "Is she bothering you?" And it was tremendous because he said, "Listen, she's wearing her mask. If the mask works, she's fine." Yes. That old man said that. If she's wearing her mask, if the mask works, she's fine. Now, if the mask works, she's fine. Do you hear him going with this? What is said out in the world around us may or may not be true. But would to God, people, could you imagine if that woman would have walked up to us and said, "Both of you, are you sleeping with your own wives? Are you doing drugs? Are you cheating on your income tax? Do you speed? You better get your act together." You know what I'm saying? Wouldn't it be great if we had a terror of sin like that? Put on your mask. How about this? Put on Christ. Put on Jesus. Put them on. Put them on. Everybody's worried about something that, listen, 99.96% you're going to recover from. Not sin. It's 100% fatal. Sin will kill you. It's dangerous. So when you look around and you realize, because maybe this is news to you, Jesus is coming. He could come back today. That should cause you, listen, to put on Christ. You want to get ready? Put on Christ. Amen. You want to get super safe? Put on the blood of Christ.
Amen. Well, I sure hope that you're beginning to see the importance of understanding Bible prophecy. And like our good friend, Dr. Ed Heinzen said, God did not give us Bible prophecy to scare us, but to prepare us. And I love the fact that Jesus said, "I told you these things before they happen." That's prophecy. That when they do, you might believe that I am He, that I'm the One. And so this is a remarkable, remarkable doctrine, remarkable section of the Bible, over one quarter of the Bible. Think about it. One fourth of the Bible is devoted to this important doctrine of eschatological teaching, future studies. That's what that means. And so, listen, I hope this is a blessing to you. I hope that you tell others. You know, one of the greatest things that you can do for us is tell other people, word of mouth. If you could tell people, you know what, go to jackgibbs.com and you can click on there. And you know what's cool? Maybe you've got a college friend that's in Canada, or maybe you've got a friend in New York, or maybe you've got a friend in San Diego, or you've got a friend in Saudi Arabia, you say, hey, why don't you join me? I'm going to go on this study and let's do this together, even though we're separated by thousands of miles. Go to jacobs.com, go through the Bible study together, get a small group in your neighborhood together. Let's do it. Let's do it. Because listen, this time, my opinion, of course, but it's pretty strong opinion. Just you being with us right now in the Bible is the greatest investment that you can be doing with your time at a time like this. So listen, go to jackgibbs.com. God bless you guys. Until next time, we'll meet you right back here.
Welcome to Real Life Radio with Jack Hibbs.
God's word never will return void. God's word is spirit, it's power, and it has its effect. So I want to encourage you to grab your Bibles, open them up, and get ready to learn from God's word. God did not give us Bible prophecy to scare us, but to prepare us. But I think you're going to get a lot out of it, and one of the great reasons.
You are the light of the world, Jesus said. You are the salt of the earth. How does that happen? By the power of the Holy Spirit.
You're going to get excited about what Jesus Christ wants to do in and through you.
Jack Hibbs truly believes we are living in some of the most exciting days in history, which brings some great opportunities to share with the world a powerful, no-nonsense presentation of the gospel to this generation who is searching for answers and truth. Will you stand with us in sharing this message in real and practical ways? We ask that you commit to support Real Life each month with a gift of your choosing. In return, our gift to you for becoming a Real Life partner, we'd like to send you this Worldview DVD. It's titled, What You Believe Defines You. Call now, 1-877-777-2346. That's 877-777-2346. Or by mail, P.O. Box 1273, Chino Hills, California, 91709. Or simply go to reallifewithjackhibbs.org. Your gift will be faithfully put to work because it's our desire that through Jesus Christ, you will know real life.